Welcome everybody for this exciting orthoptics decoded webinar. So our first session is on binocular vision, and Dr. Sabyasachi Chakravarti will be speaking on overview of binocular vision. Dr. Sabyasachi is consultant in pediatric department, Arvind Eye Hospital, Tirunelveli. He has done own hospital and has been a distinguished outstanding postgraduate. He is academically honored with FRCS Glasgow, MRCS Edinburgh, and he is on way to FRC Ophthal. So, Dr. Sabyasachi, he will be speaking on overview of binocular vision. So, over to Dr. Sabyasachi.
Thank you so much, madam, for those kind words. I'll start off today's proceedings with an overview on binocular single vision. I have no financial disclosures or conflicts of interest in the subject matter of the current presentation. So binocular single vision, according to Romano and Romano, is defined as the state of simultaneous vision by two seeing eyes, neither of which may be normal, occurring when an individual fixes on an object of regard. The most important advantage of binocular single vision is perhaps stereopsis, but apart from stereopsis, binocular single vision is also associated with a better exteroception of form and color, a better appreciation of the relationship between an individual and his environment, and obviously a binocular field of view is much better than a monocular field of view. In today's presentation, I'll go on to talk about the evolution, the neurophysiology, the psychosensory issues, and end with the theories of binocular single vision. So I'll start with the evolution of binocular single vision. Chameleons are perhaps the earliest torchbearers of a mechanism which bears some semblance to modern day binocular single vision. Under normal circumstances, the eyes of a chameleon move about independently as if seated on a turret. However, just before a tongue shot, there is functional coupling of the eyes. This cannot be likened to a true stereopsis because the images from both the eyes are not reconciled into one, but perhaps this represents an evolution or transition from independent to coupled ocular movements. Coming to avian stereopsis, avian stereopsis is way better than the form of stereopsis I have just described, but still it is crude and it is limited in range compared to mammalian stereopsis. Stereopsis in birds is best exemplified by birds of prey. These are lateral bifoveate creatures who use the lateral fovea for binocular single vision and the central fovea for fine spatial acuity. Therefore, when they are hunting, they use fovea. So the temporal foveas are used initially in order to notice or record the depth, and thereafter the nasal fovea is used to determine the fine features of the target. Coming to mammalian stereopsis, with evolution, there was gradual regression of the snout, and thereafter the laterally placed eyes came frontally. This was associated with a better degree of single vision, and this was especially helpful for predators. However, for preys, there had to be a trade-off between the safety offered by panoramic view and the magic of binocular single vision. There's a high degree of flexibility in mammalian visual systems, but it has been proven without doubt that predators such as cats have a much better stereopsis than their prey. With adoption of an upright posture, the hands were freed from postural support and they could now be used for fine manipulative tasks under visual guidance. This form of manipulative task would require frontally placed eyes because the finest task require hand-eye coordination. Therefore, with adoption of an upright posture, a new dimension was added to stereopsis, and this is best exemplified in primates by macaques and humans. Coming to the neurophysiology of binocular single vision, groundbreaking research by Huber and Wiesel on cats and macaques have led to an understanding of the neurophysiology of stereopsis. So this is a cortical neuronal histogram from the macaque visual cortex. This shows that 80% of the neurons are binocularly driven. These are represented from column 2 to column 6. Column 4 represents all those neurons which are driven by the right as well as the left eye. whereas the other columns have varying degrees of influence from both the right and the left type. Column 1 and column 7 are exclusively unilaterally driven neurons, column 1 being driven by column 7 by the right eye. So what these researchers did is they studied the shape of these histograms in different pathological conditions. For example, in case of amblyopia, they noted loss of both ipsilateral, unilateral and binocular neurons. And in case of strabismus, without amblyopia, there was loss of only the binocularly driven neurons. So although this is the neurophysiology of stereopsis, many clinicians will agree that there is sensory fusion even in the absence of stereopsis. And we are yet to find out the cortical centers for sensory fusion and motor fusion. Now I'll talk about mental perception and interpretation of sensory stimuli related to binocular single vision. So coming first to the horopter. A horopter is a locus of all those objective elements or objective points which are imaged on corresponding retinal elements in both. Coming to the Pannon's fusional area, Pannon's fusional area refers to a zone slightly in front of and behind the empirical horopter for a given fixation distance, all points on which are imaged singly, stimulate slightly non-corresponding retinal elements and give rise to the perception of stereopsis. The Pannon's fusional area is slightly wider in the periphery than in the center. And all points outside the Pannon's fusional area for a given fixation distance gives rise to physiological diplopia. The differences between perception and reality are best exemplified by these examples in monocular and binocular viewing. So if one tries to bisect a monocularly fixated line in a visual field that excludes all other clues, a constant error is noted. This forms the basis of the Kundt-Münsterberg experiments. Similarly, a monocularly fixated plumb line always shows a temporal tilt towards the top by 4 to 5 degrees. Fixation disparity is perhaps an error of binocular viewing, which is seen in binocular single vision. It is defined as the minute degree of displacement of an image within the Pannon's fusional area while fusion is being maintained. Fixation disparity has been used by Ogle and co-workers to determine the AC by A ratio experimentally. Coming to the grades of binocular single vision, simultaneous perception simply defines the ability of the eyes to perceive two different images simultaneously. Fusion refers to the ability to form a composite image from two similar images which are slightly lacking in a minute detail. Stereopsis is defined as the ability to perceive depth from two images of the same object captured from slightly different viewing angles. Coming to the theories of binocular single vision. So according to the alternation theory, a binocular visual field is composed of a mosaic of monocularly perceived patches. This alternation theory can explain retinal rivalry but fails to explain logical phenomena associated with binocular single vision, namely stereopsis. According to the projections theory, visual stimuli are exteriorized along the lines of direction. Therefore, if something is being seen binocularly, a bicentric projection is generated which places the impression of that object for that eye at the point of intersection of the lines of direction. The projection theory fails to explain physiological diplopia and sensory anomalies found in case of strabismus, and therefore is not widely accepted. The isomorphism theory is based on rigid relationships. According to this theory, stimulation of corresponding retinal elements results in excitations which are united in the Jennery stripes. The Jennery stripes have been referred to as the anatomical variant of the horopter plane. However, the isomorphism theory cannot again be accepted because such rigidity is not accepted in physiological systems. Finally, the correspondence and disparity theory was proposed, which is the most accepted theory. It has also been proven neurophysiologically. This theory states that binocular is achieved by the system of corresponding retinal elements as described before. So this theory also states that fusion with stereopsis and diplopia without stereopsis are not strictly black and white, and there is no clear delineation between them. Coming to the relevance of all this. So for our ancestors, stereopsis would have provided a great survival advantage because it would have let them look through camouflage, even in objects which they had never seen before. But for a modern day human, stereopsis no longer provides such a survival advantage because there are a large number of secondary sensory cues, as shown here, which can be used to assess distance and depth. So I want to conclude by saying that rather than achieving the advantages of normal depth perception, the goal of present day orthoptic therapy is to remove the disadvantage of the disorders of BSB, namely suppression, confusion and diplopia. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sabyasachi, for such a nice elaborative description. And I think he has done his job very nicely, and he has made us realize that Darwin's theory still holds true even though centuries have passed. So right now, our next presentation. The next presentation is our old friend, the Sinoptophon, and speaker is Mr. Prem Kumar Singh. He is head of Department of Optometry Vision Science at Schroff's Charity Eye Institute, New Delhi. He had more than 20 years of vast experience in orthoptics and optometry, and he is regularly conducting seminars for optometry students and for doctors. And he is volunteer faculty of Orbis International. So welcome, Mr. Prem Kumar Singh, over to you for your presentation. Mr. Prem, you have to share the screen. Yeah, you can now open it.
Yeah, am I audible now?
Yeah, it's clear. Yeah, you can go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Neelam, for the nice introduction. I want to thank all the respectable seniors from Arvind Eye System for giving me this opportunity to share my learnings and the experience about the Sinoptophon that I had over the time. If I can recall, around 20 years back when I was a student of orthoptics, there were so many things to learn, I know. And I know, I'm sure there'll be other people agreeing with this. The terms like subjective and objective angle, primary, secondary deviation, 9 cardinal directions of gaze, torsions, retinal disparities, suppression scotomas, retinal correspondence, ARC, NRC, angle kappa, and a lot more to learn. And it wasn't easy to actually relate that with the eyes at that stage. So definitely I'd like to thank this equipment, which we call Sinoptophon, which actually helped in practically demonstrating all these terms, practicing on each other, and giving that clarity and understanding about all these terms, which are so often practiced in our clinical practice in today's time. So before I go for the details and see how I found Sinoptophon useful in diagnosing and therapy of various problems in our clinic, let's understand the brief about the principle and optics and how it works actually. So we all know that it's based on the principle of haploscopic, where there's a physical space which is divided into the two separate areas of visual space, and each of this area of visual space actually is visible to only one of the eyes. And here the object which is there on the slide holder in the site and the image, if you see it as a either you as a patient or you just try it, then the image is seen just in front of it and it appears as if it's coming from the distance. In fact, I had as a student had a lot of questions at that time. How
we have lost connection. Dr. Mr. Prem Kumar will be soon joining us back.
Yeah,
you can continue, Mr. Prem, from the slide, from the previous slide on.
Hello. Sorry, I think there was some issue in the connectivity.
Please,
Dr. Neelam, am I audible now? Okay.
Yes,
so,
yes.
As I was saying, this is how it works. So there's a lens of 6.5 diopter in each of the eyepiece. This till the object, which is there in the slide. This is called the focal length of the lens. And as we know, any object which is placed at the focal length and the ray which passed through this, that reflects as a parallel ray. And this is what exactly happens in the synaptophore. So that's how the image appears to be at the distance There's no accommodation part which is taking place in this, and that's how it is presumed to be working for the distance. It can also be made to work for near by inducing the accommodation with the help of the minus lenses. So suppose you put a -3 lens in this lens holder here, then you make the patient to accommodate for around 3 diopters, and that's how you get the recordings for the near. These are the slides. As we know, the three different grades of binocularity: foveal, which is around 1 degree, macular around 3 degree, and paramacular, which is around 5 degree. So depending upon the visual acuity, you can choose. Depending upon the size of suppression scotoma, we decide the slide for the patient. Out of these two slides that you see, one is a smaller picture, other one is the bigger one. Always the smaller picture is called a fixating slide, and the other one is a non-fixating, and where they can overlap and get the recording for the SMP. Similarly for the fusion, where you have the two similar pictures, but they are incomplete. And when they fuse, they make a complete picture, where you can have a sensory assessment of fusion, as well as the motor assessment, where you can check the range of fusion in terms of adduction and abduction, which is called positive vergence and the negative vergence. And then you have the stereopsis slides, where you can have a qualitative assessment with this. Apart from these three grades of slides, you have other additional slides, which are like a slide which is called after image slide, where there's a vertical and a horizontal streak with a central red fixation mark in the center. And then it helps you with some stimulation for around 20 seconds. And then you can ask the patient for the patterns. And if patient reports with a cross, that means patient have a normal retinal correspondence. And if you see only the single streak, that means he's suppressing with either of the eye, depending upon which streak he's not seeing. And if there's an ARC, then you find the pattern, a different kind of, where they're not fusing with each other actually. Apart from these slides, there is an additional attachment which is called Hadinger brushes, which has a polarized revolving light inside it. And this is seen with the blue filter again in the eyepiece by the patient, where it acts as an entoptic phenomena, which is produced over the fovea. Basically, if you see, entoptic phenomena is kind of subtle gray shadow which is seen. That's because of the special kind of pigment which is there on the fovea. We call that xanthophilic pigment, which is there yellowish in color. And when this blue revolving light passes through that, and the shadow is seen as a gray subtle shadow. And since it's revolving, so this is seen as a brush which revolves inside, which the patient sees as a revolving one, particular kind of pigment which is present at the fovea. So this is how it becomes important for many of our amblyopic conditions and eccentric fixation treatment, where you're trying to stimulate more as the foveal region. This is the last slide that I'll talk about, where there's the angle kappa, and we see the pseudo strabismus, which could be because of positive angle kappa or negative angle kappa. So this slide helps in assessing the degree of angle kappa that patient has. Like, you make the patient look at the zero mark, the picture which is there, and if the reflex is not in the center of the pupil, then accordingly you ask the patient to switch to fixation to the next star, and then you can grade it to what degree of angle kappa patient has. Okay, apart from these functions of the synaptophore, actually in practice over the years I have had a lot of dilemmas, and that's because of the variety of other equipment which are available. Although I said I had a lot of learning from this, which act as a complete set for orthoptic clinic, but you find it much more convenient when you are seeing a patient on a single chair sitting, and you can dust from reflection, vision, and all oculomotor and sensory assessment on the same sitting. Then why there is a need for this? And in fact, not only even many therapies which has come up as a vision therapy now, and also electronic devices, the computer programs are there, where they claim to be having the diagnostic tools in that, where you can assess a lot of the oculomotor functions through the computer program. So I'll see how in the presence of this, how can we found that by how still I find the synaptophore as an important tool for us. So if you see the measurement for various deviation, which we can do simply in a sitting with the loose prism, but there are certain conditions, like in a paralytic squint, when we are looking for measurement for each eye fixation separately. So you can have a measurement with each eye fixating separately to come to know primary and secondary deviation. You can come to know about the objective and subjective angles simultaneously measured with the help of synaptophore, where you can, particularly in adult squint, when you're looking to operate them, and they are always at the high risk of having ARC because of the long-term strabismus that they have having, and you may end up, if you're going for a surgery for the measurement angle as per the prism that we have got, patient may have a diplopia after that. So this becomes an important area where you can again have objective and subjective angle for ARC with this. In more complex squints where there's a measurement of or the all three becomes much easier with the synaptophore. And then in incompetent cases and paralytic cases, as I said, you can have a measurement in different nine cardinal directions of gaze. Here the problem which I face with the routine clinical measurement, we are making the patient to fixate with a different head turn position to look for the different gazes. If somebody has done this much or somebody has done this much, you may find variations in the measurement. But on synaptophore, you can have much more controlled measurement, where for the lateral gazes, you are changing the position of the fixation tube from 0 to 15 degree laterally. So suppose for the left eye, you're fixing eye tube, then you move 15 degree out, and you'll be measuring for the left eye fixation levoversion. And same way, left eye fixation dextroversion, you move the tube from 0 to 15 degree in. And similarly, you can move the tubes vertically, where 10 degree you are moving up, and that remains constant. So even if you're following visit, you're comparing the findings, then you find it much more correlating and much more controlled way which you have assessed these nine cardinal directions of gaze. For the duction assessments, as you see, in all the clinics, we see people follow different methods for recording the duction limitations. And like we, in our system, we does this. The dark line shows the limitation of duction beyond this point. Here again, synaptophore is quite useful way I see. So starting from the zero, you make the patient to look for a target and gradually start moving the tube. Ask the patient to follow the target until you find there's a movement of the eye and the patient is able to see the target, and the point where he's not able to do that, that becomes a point for your limitation. So which you can objectively record, quantitatively record, and then you can compare on the following visit. As I said, for the elderly patients, and which is very commonly seen in our country, people still come for the squint surgery at the later stages. And this is where you can assess these kind of patients for the fusion ability and the potential on the synaptophore, where you can compensate the angle of a squint, whether it's eso or exo, by moving the tube and adjusting as per the angle of division. And then you can assess whether the patient has a fusion or has a suppression or he has an ART if there is a difference in the subjective and objective angle. So you can come to know about all these findings from this. So this was the diagnostic areas where I found it useful. If I talk from the treatment point of view as a therapy, definitely areas of suppression is mapped out. And again, for the suppression, you can even use it for the therapy also, where you can map out the area of suppression, you can measure the size of suppression, where the object disappears and reappears. The reading where you find it is reappearing, and from there you minus the one where it disappeared first, so you find the size of scotoma. And even you can have the estimation about the suppression scotoma, whether it is partial or it is complete. Like once the object disappears for the eye which is suppressing, and then you can dim the illumination of the fixating eye which is seeing, and slowly keep dimming it till the object reappears. So if reappears, that means the partial suppression is there. If it doesn't come, even making the completely illumination completely extinguished, then that means patient is having a deep suppression. Even the AC over A ratio can be assessed with this, where we are measuring the distance deviation as normal we does, and then by adding the minus three lenses. So whatever the value you are getting in under minus three lenses, from that you subtract the one which you got for the distance without any lenses and divide it by three, and that's how you get the value of the AC over A ratio, which we call as a gradient method. So from therapy point of view, see, in most of the places we see people use synaptophore in the hospitals, in personal, in private clinics, even in the opticals, we have seen somewhere some kind of convergence of Devens exercise are done for the patient. In our clinic, yes, we just find it useful for particularly small children, because for the Verger therapy, there are a lot of other options which are available nowadays. So the children who are not able to understand that patterns on the Brock string and all the expectation that we have from them, then it's much more easier at this age group to do the Verger therapies on the synaptophore. As I'm saying, you can measure the size of suppression. Simultaneously, you can even go, you can have the macular massage, where over the area of suppression scotoma, you are gradually moving the object, which could be a SMP slide or it could be a fusion slide, and gradually you does with the speed. And when you find that patient is coming out of suppression, gradually you reduce the speed. And when the patient starts seeing that object without moving, that means that you have held the patient is coming out of the suppression scotoma from for that point of view. As I was saying earlier, we're adding the brushes. So this is where we use it to see if the patient, particularly in dense amblyopic patient, whether they are fixating with the fovea or not. So if you make them see this Haidinger brush, the entoptic phenomena, that gray subtle target that they're seeing inside will be visible only when patient is fixating with the fovea. And that we already explained about it, why that happens. So that is something which you can use. And particularly eccentric fixation patients where we want to treat them if they come at the right age. So after the inverse occlusion, after disturbing their centricity, then to fix, to develop their centricity with the fovea, we take help of Haidinger brushes, which plays a key role in that, where we try to improve the fixation for the foveal area and then go for the simultaneous other therapies as we have in the clinic. So this is what actually all, if you see, there are a lot of things are there in the practice to go for, but still I could see their conditions, their particular situations where I found synaptophore as the best friend for us. So this is exactly the same way they said, whether celebrating life or experiences and unexpected bumps, if one can always be there, that's a friend. So it's always been a loyal and a dependable for us for certain conditions where we really find synaptophore a useful friend for us. Thank you.
Thank you, Prem Kumar, for a very nice presentation. And thank you for sharing your journey with the synoptophore and brushing our orthoptic knowledge of synoptophore. Though I know synoptophore is a wonderful instrument, but it is less widely used all over the world because we are not having so much knowledge about it. So again, thanks a lot for your presentation.
Thank you.
So the next speaker, Dr. Rupa, she will be speaking on techniques of near and distance binocular single vision assessment. Dr. Rupa is a consultant in Department of Pediatric Ophthalmology at Arvind Eye Hospital, Madurai, and she has elaborative experience, 16 years of experience in pediatric ophthalmology, and she's taking care of pediatric electrophysiology in Arvind Eye Hospital, Madurai. So over to you, Dr. Rupa.
Am I audible, Dr. Nila?
Yeah, it's clear. Your voice is pretty clear.
Yeah.
Just make it full screen. Yeah, it's clear.
Yeah, no? Shall I start? Okay. I thank this opportunity for with Madam, Dr. Meenakshi Madam and Dr. Neelam for giving me this opportunity. So I'm going to speak on distant and near techniques of binocular vision. So the learning objects will be to know the various tests, the aims, principles, and how to perform these tests, and interpretation of results in various strabismic conditions, advantages and disadvantages of these conditions. So I think we had a lot of discussion on binocular single vision. We know the advantages of binocular single vision, that it's very important for stereopsis, color, form, then the single vision it gives a larger field for us, and it also helps in the control of manipulation of reach and balance of the body to the environment. So let's look at the adaptations in strabismus. It's already discussed. So what happens in a manifest deviation? Lot of sensory responses come into play, that is confusion, diplopia, and as a disposable mechanism, suppression develops. When it becomes extreme, amblyopia develops. Coming to the assessment of BSV, we have suppression tests, stereopsis tests, ARC tests, and if you see the diplopia stress and suppression and ARC, they all have overlapping functions. So we will discuss in detail next. So the aims of this is to assess the presence or absence of normal, abnormal retinal correspondence, then to see whether there is a suppression, simultaneous purpose perception, fusion with small some amplitude, and stereopsis. So the prerequisites are, before any test is undertaken, it's essential to assess the visual acuity, fixation in the squinting eye, direction, and size of the deviation. Coming to stereo acuity test, it will be divided into near and distance. Sometimes you see that the same charts are used for both near and distance. So I'll talk about in the detail about them. The most essential thing about these acuity tests are two eyes should be dissociated properly. Each eye must be presented with a separate field of view. Each of the two fields must be imaged on corresponding retinal areas. Principles of stereo test. So the haplotrope principle, as Mr. Prem Kumar was explaining, mostly used in cyanoptophore, uses a dissociation by using angled mirrors in front of each eye. And anaglyphs used details as a dissociation by using colored glasses. And the examples are TNO test. Vectorographic, it uses dissociation again by using Polaroid filters, mostly used in Titmus fly test and random dot stereograms. Panographic, it calls a rear depth stereogram which uses cylinders or prisms. Examples are Lang's test, Frisby-Davis distance stereo test. Cyanoptophore was already being discussed extensively. So these are the simple stereograms. So they have three circles. If they are concentric, it is suggestive of stereopsis. If the eccentric inner circle is eccentric, then it is suggestive of suppression. Then you should always ask the patient whether the central circle is towards the left or towards the right, and then we can decide which eye is suppressed. Next, we have Titmus fly test. It's a very popular and easy test. Why the fly is included in this test is because most of the children are knowing the insect fly, hence the fly is coming to the role. So the first, this is the first the fly picture just orients and establishes a gross stereopsis of 3000 seconds of arc, and the next is the nine sets of circles with four patterns provided, which provide a fine grating thresholds ranging from 800 to 40 seconds of arc. And then you have these animals, three rows of animals, 1 mm in each row, has a disparity of 100, 200, and 400 seconds of arc. Methods, first thing is you can ask the child to hold or touch the wings. That is the most important thing. And if the child holds or touches the wings, it's known that he's got a very good stereopsis, or if he goes very close, then probably you can expect that the child is not having good stereopsis. Next thing is ask which one of the animals stands out, and then ask the child to push down the circle that stands out. Again, to reconfirm, you can turn book 90 degrees and then it becomes flat. Stereoability of 40 second arc is suggestive of bifoveal fixation. Worse than 40 seconds of arc is suggestive of peripheral fusion. So the advantages of this test is it evaluates both gross and fine stereopsis. It's easy to perform. The disadvantages are it's only for near acuity. Artifactual stereo capability when none exists can occur, and it only measures a local stereopsis using the monocular tools. Coming to random dot stereograms, this is the principle of this is if this contains these balls, these noise of visual noise don't contain any information actually. When you see, it doesn't have any information about what object is present inside these noises. So only when the images from the right and the left eye are combined, the object is seen in depth. That is either when you convert the eyes or use prisms. So when you translate them, you have two squares identical, we have two squares with identical dot distribution. These are all dot distributions, and there is a hidden central square. So they have the A and B scaling is there. Of these central squares, when they get shifted horizontally, and they are these images are fused, they elicit stereopsis. These random dot stereos grams are used in most of the stereo tests. So the random dot stereo test is similar to Titmus flight, except that we have that random dot stereograms here. You can see that. It's kept at 40 centimeters. It has got three parts. Right side has got 8 stereograms. It is measuring up to 660 seconds of arc. Left side has got circles and animals. Similarly, we have this Randot E stereograms, which can be placed at 50 centimeters. And you ask the child to indicate which card contains E. A pass or a fail response can be given from this test. It can also be used as a quantitative test while increasing the distance from the patient. Advantage is it is used as a preschool vision screening test. The disadvantage is most of the children wouldn't like to wear red-green glasses or Polaroid glasses. So the non-acceptance of these glasses might make it a disadvantage, and it has got monocular clues. Similarly, we have even Randot E smile charts, which can be shown to babies. I have not put the picture, sorry. And next we have TNO test. The principle is, again, it's an anaglyph and random dot stereogram. The parts, it's got 7 plates graded to provide retinal disparities ranging from 15 to 480 seconds of arc. The next is the most favorite for small children below 4 years, that is Lang's test. It is, there is test 1 and test 2 types. Test 1 has got a car of 550 seconds of arc, star of 600 seconds of arc, cat is about 1200 seconds of arc disparity shows. Test 2 is having moon, duck, elephant, and star can be seen with only one eye. That is the furthest one. So the principle is again a panographic presentation of random dots. Separate image is provided to each eye. It's placed at 40 centimeters distance. Advantage, it is also easy for use as a screening test, and no glasses are needed. That is what is very useful. And it's more convenient to use in uncooperative children as young as 30 months old also. So the disadvantage is only a gross stereopsis is established with Lang test 1. Frisbee-Davis test, the principle is again panographic. They have targets printed on the two sides of transparent plexiglass plates of different thickness. Three plates are there, 1 millimeter, 3 millimeter, 6 millimeter thickness. A hidden circle has to be identified at these. Next, distant Randot stereo test. The stimuli is again random dot stereogram, and principle is vectorographic because we are using Polaroid glasses. It has got one book containing 8 shapes, 2 shapes at each of 4 disparities and 4 pages. And the stereo targets are very simple geometric shapes like triangle, square, star, and circle. And usually they are given with a one matching card also. So you can give the child to match also. Method is, it is done at a distance of 3 meters. Testing is started with coarse disparity of 400 seconds of arc and proceeded to progressively smaller disparities up to 60 seconds of arc. Testing begins with a picture labeled 400A followed by 400B. If the subject correctly matches or names both shapes at the 400 seconds of arc level. AO vectorographic project slide test, again the principle is vectorographic. Parts are, they have a polarizing lens on a 4-opter. Disparities from 480 to 30 seconds of arc can be measured. Top portion of each slide is a standard non-vectorographic projector slide. The bottom portion is vectorographic. Disadvantages, it provides monocular clues. Coming to suppression test, the most and easily done thing is sighted glasses of Bagaloni. The aim of this test is to confirm the presence or normal or abnormal BSV, to assess BSV or suppression in manifest deviation pre-op assessment of sensory fusion. So as we see, we have these striated glasses angled at 135 degrees and 45 degrees. So what is the thing is, this child will fix on a spotlight with best corrected glasses if they are using. And then over that the Baglioni glasses are used. So we should ask them how many number of lights you are seeing, what's the number of lines you are seeing, and what is the position of the light on the lines, and whether the lines are crossed or separated. So usually it is both the near and distance, done at 6 meters and 33 centimeters, can be done at even desired gazes also. So when they fix, we see they can see a line. So this is the view of the left eye and view of the right eye. So you can ask the child to write the lines better, so that we'll be able to assess if any gaps are there and the position also. So the results are, when they're crossed, it can be due to orthotropia with a normal retinal correspondence or a heterotropia with the ARC. And when only one line is there, it is a suppression of the other eye. And when there's a gap here, though the grass crossed is seen, there's a gap, it occurs in monofixation where a central suppression is occurring. And in esotropic with NRC, we'll see a V pattern. And in exotropia with NRC, we see a crossed diplopia. So the test is as close to natural conditions of seeing. So this is the best dissociating test. It does not alter the accommodation, visual acuity, and perception of visual space. Coming to our friendly Wirthford dot test, it's the most common and popular test and very easy, and is a very cheap test. Coming to the aims, it confirms the presence of suppression, mainly the peripheral, and diplopia in manifest deviation. And even the presence or absence of fusion can be made out by this test. It is again a dissociating test using red-green glasses. So method is, you occlude one eye and ask the patient to note how many lights are seen by the patient. So it is done at 6 meters and 33 centimeters as we have shown. And if the patient sees 5 lights, then again you can place prisms and ask them to tell how many lights they are seeing. If they see 4, that confirms the presence of fusion. So results are like, you can see sometimes lights might change color in alternating suppression. That's one thing you should be aware. As I said, 5 lights are seen in manifest strabismus without suppression. And this is very dissociating in dark. So it's better to always do it in a room light. So these are all the responses. When 4 lights are present, fusion is there. Only when the 2 lights are present, the suppression of other eye, as seen in both pictures. This is a 5 lights seen with diplopia. So as I said, the advantages are, it's a low cost, easy test. It identifies the monofixation syndrome, that is central suppression and peripheral fusion, in a patient with small angle strabismus. The disadvantage is, in patients with unstable but functionally useful binocular vision, it may exhibit a suppression response. That's why it's not very popular sometimes. The presence or absence of bifocal fusion cannot be assessed with this test. To measure the depth of the suppression, we can use this red filter ladder. It has got a series of red filters of increasing density arranged in the form of ladder. It consists of gelatin filters beginning with one layer and increasing to 6 or 8 layers. The patient fixes on a spotlight and the filter is placed in front of the eye. With increasing layers, development of diplopia is suggestive of suppression. And this is a very easy test to do in the clinic. A red filter for ARC and suppression. You can see that when you place the red filter in these patients, ESO cross diplopia will show a light next to the uncrossed way, and in EXO, it's a crossed diplopia. And this is suppression seen in patient with a scotoma. And you can place this one, prism, that is vertical prism, to note, differentiate between the NRC and ARC also. And the last test is a 4 prism diopter base out test, where a bifocal It detects the bifocal fusion in small suppression scotomas under binocular condition, and it also assesses the quality of binocular vision in post-operative patient. And this is the picture and how we are doing the 4-prism diopter test. And so to summarize, thank you. To summarize, what I want to tell is there are so many various tests, from a small test to a large apparatus. So what is advisable to all clinicians is whatever is very conventional and useful for them and what is easy should be used as a clinical practice rather than going through too many tests to make the patients, assess the binocular single vision. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rupa ma'am, for going through details of stereopsis. And with surgical ophthalmic advancement, we are really approaching the era of three-dimensional surgeries. And in future, maybe surgeon stereopsis will also play a major role than besides patient stereopsis. So thank you for a very nice presentation.
Thank you, Dr.
Thank you, Sabyasachi, Mr. Prem Kumar, and Rupa for the wonderful presentation in the first session. Now we are moving on into the second part, pediatric refraction potpourri. And we have with us as the first speaker, Dr. Neelam. Dr. Neelam is our consultant at Tirunelveli, and she's been with us for more than 10 years. And she's given many cybersight lectures. I don't know if you recently, last month also, she gave a lecture on myopia. And she has a lot of publications to her credit. She's a very excellent surgeon. And welcome, Neelam. And you can give your talk on tips and tricks in pediatric refraction.
Yeah, thank you, madam. Good afternoon, everybody. I will be talking on tips and tricks in pediatric refraction. So if we see the development of eye at birth, the mean axial length is 6.6 to 17 millimeter, and mean K is around 51 diopter. And during the first few months of life, there is rapid increase in axial length of the eye, and cornea reaches its adult size by the age of 2 years, but the eye continues to grow in anteroposterior length until age of 7 to 8 years. So refractive error typically from hyperopia towards myopia as children age. And roughly 80% of the children between 2 to 6 years are hyperopic, and 10% of these children need refractive correction before 8 years of age. And if we see this famous Jordan's curve, it shows that during first 2 years of life, there is rapid increase in axial length, which manifests rapid increase in ocular growth, which manifests as flattening of cornea and increase in axial length, which leads to shift of eye from hyperopia towards emetropia. So during the process of emetropization, various factors like genetic, environmental, and microenvironmental components play a role in ocular growth. And multitude of these factors are responsible for deviation of emetropization process, leading to refractive error. The uncorrected refractive errors are most common cause of visual impairment in children, and overall overall blindness worldwide. And uncorrected refractive errors in children can lead to lot of problems with their development, their educational opportunities, academic activities, quality of life, and their eventual career opportunities. So the American Optometric Association recommends that all children should have their first eye examination at 6 months of age. The results of reliability studies supports Bannon's 1977 conclusion that conventional subjective refraction is reliable within 0.25 to 0.50 diopter, but this conventional subjective refraction is not possible in children. So manual retinoscopy is still gold standard, and use of auto hyperoptometer in children without cycloplegia may underestimate the actual hyperopia and overestimate the actual myopia due to increased proximal convergence and accommodation. So manual retinoscopy is still the most accurate technique to estimate refractive status in children. So is cycloplegic autorefraction is same as cycloplegic retinoscopy? So there are few studies which have compared the cycloplegic photorefraction autorefractometer and cycloplegic retinoscopy in children, and they found that results were similar with all the method. While some studies shows that autorefractor, even after cycloplegia, they produce false measurement, which is approximately one diopter more myopia than the post-cycloplegic retinoscopy in children. And even there is consensus that the consistency is observed in most of the methods of retinoscopy in terms of sphere and spherical equivalence, but this consistency drops in terms of cylindrical values, and no consistency is observed in excess values with the autorefractometers and photorefractometers. So it is very important that we should not solely rely on the cylindrical values and excess values of photorefractometer and autorefractometer. So cycloplegic refraction remains the mainstay of pediatric refraction, and every child has the right of cycloplegic refraction, and they should not be denied of this. And retinoscopy can be done anywhere in OPD, when child sitting alone, when child is in mother's lap and in operating room, or even when child is taking feet. And sometimes we even do get opportunity to do refraction when the kids and parents are just about to leave the clinic. So when to do cyclorefraction in children? In all cases of strabismus, and it should be repeated if amblyopia is not improving, there is still a residual angle with glasses, and better to repeat cyclopegic refraction in strabismus. In children where vision is less than 6x6 along with asthenopic symptoms, in children with high variable dynamic refraction and accommodative spasm, children having family history of refractive error, and even if children are having no sign and symptoms, at least they should be given opportunity of cycloplegic refraction before school entry. So there are 5 W's of refraction. Who is going to do the refraction, what you are going to see, where you are going to do, and when and why to prescribe the glasses. So this is the quote from Duke Elder's book. It is how that about retinoscopy. It is, however, an art which cannot be learned from books, for efficiency can only be attained by long, assiduous, and painstaking practice. And pediatric ophthalmology is tedious. It is frustrating, and one has to keep lot of patience while doing it. So refraction in pediatric cases is mainly objective refraction, and it involves retinoscopy, keratometry, autorefractometry, and aberrometry can be done in some cases. And in very young children, this is the sole method of prescribing glasses when subjective refraction is not possible. The refraction in older children can be done by refining the objective values to arrive a final prescription, and can involve fogging, duochrome test, Jackson cylinder, astigmatic fan, and binocular balancing for refinement. So dynamic retinoscopy in children is done specially when they are at risk for accommodative insufficiency, those having significant hyperopia and with non-physiologic visual complaint. And in dynamic retinoscopy, the main aim is to measure the effectiveness of accommodation rather than refractive error itself, because here accommodation is active. While in wet retinoscopy, the accommodation is not active, and it is useful, as already we have discussed the indication of cycloplegia, it is useful in young preverbal children, those with strabismus, hyperopia, accommodative spasm, in mentally incompetent patient, and when symptoms are not matching the nature of manifest refractive error. So types of pediatric refraction: objective, if see, it can be done by static retinoscopy when target is at distance, and dynamic retinoscopy when a near target is used. And then subjective refraction can be done with and without cycloplegia. So there are different type of dynamic retinoscopy. So Sommer, he used his monocular estimate method in which there is a stationary target in form of MEM cards which are attached to the retinoscope itself, and here the retinoscope position is also stationary. So it is a very good method which is done at around distance of 40 centimeter, and not only gives us idea about refraction, it also gives us estimates of accommodation properties like accommodative lag and lead, and it is very useful in cases of progression of myopia where we can see increased accommodative lag. In not retinoscopy, as we can see here, the target is stationary but retinoscope is moving, and in Bell retinoscopy the target is moving while retinoscopy is kept at stationary position. So every retinoscopy method has some advantages and disadvantages, but the most preferable one is MEM. Another retinoscopy method is Mohindra technique, in which child is asked to look at the retinoscope light and room is darkened, and whatever values you do after retinoscopy, adjust it by subtracting 1.25 diopter, though it is useful but not as good as cycloplegic retinoscopy. So the retinoscopy can be done with manual method by mirror or by streaked retinoscope, by auto refractometer or portable, and with photo screener. Ideal pediatric frame should be used, and if child is very young, the examiner can hold the trial lenses in front of eye, and even one can use these trial sets or racks. So selection of cycloplegic drugs depends on the age and depending on duration of action. They are divided mainly into four types, which you commonly use. Atropine sulfate 1% ointment is usually used for less than 5 years. Peak effect comes at 2 to 3 days, and duration of action lasts for 10 to 20 days. Ometropine is also sometimes used for children 5 to 8 years of age. Cyclopentolate hydrochloride is most commonly used, and it can be used for all ages from 5 to 20 years. And tropicamide again can be used for all ages, and onset of action is very fast. But still we are not having an ideal cycloplegic, because for a cycloplegic to be ideal, it should have a rapid onset of effect, maximal effect, and fast recovery of accommodation, and it should be away from any ocular and systemic side effect. So tropicamide might not produce ataxia and mydriasis, and it should be used very cautiously in infants and patients with high hyperopia or strabismus. Then which drop to use and how many drops to use? The muscarinic antagonist cyclopentolate paralyzes the ciliary muscle, while phenylephrine, which is alpha agonist, it paralyzes the iris constrictor. So in a survey among the JAPOS members, 522 pediatric ophthalmologists, they preferred the most common mixture, which is tropicamide, cyclopentolate and phenylephrine, and which was followed by cyclopentolate and phenylephrine drops. While in a recent study by Moorfields Hospital, they said that right now it is time to drop the phenylephrine from the pediatric cycloplegic, and even they have modified their practice through audit. So this is the photo of a patient, Katya's, which I observed during my observership in Baltimore. And here you can see the optometrist is putting drop with closed eye near the medial canthus. So placing one drop of cyclopentolate on a closed eyelid had a success rate of complete cycloplegia, which is equivalent to placing one drop directly on the cornea. And even there is a clinical randomized trial proving the effectiveness of this method. And this method can be used in special kids and for uncooperative kids. The cycloplegic regimen which we follow is cyclopentolate 1% drop, which is used 1 to 2 times, and with 5 to 10 minutes apart, and in between tropicamide. So first set of drop is cyclopentolate, followed by tropicamide after 5 to 10 minutes, and third is again cyclopentolate if needed. And this is then seen after 45 to around 80 minutes. So in infant less than 6 months, cyclomidrazole drop 0.5% is used, apply punctal occlusion, combo drops can be used, atropine is also used. Along with all these drops, a topical anesthetic drop can be used to increase the penetration and to have less stinging sensation. So there are various comparative studies which have done comparison on cycloplegic refraction with atropine, tropicamide and cyclopentolate, and they and most of the studies found that atropine usually overestimates the hyperopia, but in myopes the results were almost same. So as we know, atropine can have adverse effect like fever, flushing, prolonged blurry vision, delirium and convulsions, and cyclopentolate has mainly central nervous system reaction. So it is contraindicated in children with epilepsy and other neurologic disorders. And we do receive phone calls from parents in evening after cycloplegic instillation, and parents been saying that there is some behavioral problem with child after instilling these drops. So before approaching for cycloplegic refraction, a fast Bruckner's test can be done with undilated pupil in a dim room with a direct ophthalmoscope. And usually in cases of myopia, there is inferior crescent, and with hyperopia there is superior crescent, and in case of ametropia you will see equal reflexes in both eyes. So it can be used as a rapid screening to detect significant refractive error. So once cycloplegic drops are instilled, the working distance we calculate according to examiner's arm's length, and a common working distance of 67 centimeter is used, which gives us a working distance lens of plus 1.5 diopters. So whenever there is ongoing retinoscopy, there is with motion, and it is usually neutralized with plus 1.5 diopter or plus 2 lens. So after subtracting the working distance of plus 1.5, the resultant is 0, which means that there is no refractive error. In case of hyperopia, we get with motion movement and examiner for neutralizing with more plus lenses. And in case of mild myopia or myopia of just minus 1, we will get with motion, and in high myopia, with moderate and high myopia, we will see against motion while doing retinoscopy. So usually dull reflexes is seen in cases of high myopia and hypermetropia, and it is difficult to get the end point of neutralization. So most commonly in pediatric cases, we see with the rule astigmatism, their cornea is deeper in vertical media and flatter in horizontal media. So more plus power is required to neutralize the horizontal meridia, and whatever values you get in vertical and horizontal media, you have to subtract to minus 1 for your working distance, and then final prescription is given. And in against the rule astigmatism, the reverse thing is there. More plus power will be required to do the neutralize the vertical meridia. But in children, you have to do retinoscopy fast, otherwise they will not cooperate for much time. So again, in this example, this is showing pre-cycloplegic subjective refraction. After cycloplegia, we get this value, minus 1.5 is subtracted, and resultant is minus 6 at vertical, minus 4 at horizontal right eye, and here minus 5.5 in vertical and minus 4 in horizontal after subtracting the working distance. So the resultant power will be in right eye minus 4 diopter sphere with minus 2 diopter cylinder at 180, and in left eye minus 4 with minus 1.5 diopter cylinder at 180, which is more commonly what we see in pediatric patient with the rule astigmatism. After calculating the retinoscopic value and having subjective refraction, the main four steps of refinement of subjective refraction are Jackson's cross cylinder. Though in pediatric cases it is very difficult for very young children, because often they give you confusing result, but in older children it works pretty well. And then fogging technique with plus classes and binocular balancing you can do with the prism. And Duke-Chrome test is very friendly. If the green side of the screen is more clear, the eye is over minus, and with plus power and more plus power is required. So usual mnemonic is RAM gap, that is whenever there is red color, add minus. Whenever with the green they are more comfortable, then add plus. So basic tenets are assessment of polarity of the error, assessment of magnitude of error, assessment of excess if any, and refinement of the prescription. So in cases of pediatric refraction, as soon as you are going to do refraction, just have a short look for any lip abnormalities or any stye. Do cover and uncover test. Do retinoscopy quickly with confidence, because you don't know whether child will be cooperative for how much time. Always note the type of chart which you are using to check the visual acuity. Children are expert in peeking, so make sure that one eye is properly covered, and always check uniocular and binocular visual acuity. Check visual acuity with pinhole. A 6-monthly checkup is required in all kids, and those with not any symptoms, they can be reviewed yearly. Don't change glasses for very small prescription. Delayed milestone or poor growth may be associated with refractive error, and always talk freely and friendly to children. And parents' education is also important. So in myopia, do not undercorrect, because undercorrection leads to progression of myopia, and in hypermetropia, give full correction. So retinoscopy is an art, and it needs a lot of practice in your clinic. And even if you want, you can use retinoscopic simulators, which are available at the AO site, and there are some other sites in which you can practice. Then away from normal, in keratoconus, you will see seizuring reflex. And for most of the cases of astigmatism and in fromfrostic keratoconus, it is better to do an op scan. In traumatic cases and in corneal scar cases, they are induced irregular astigmatism. So one has to rely on subjective refraction. The next is post-midriatic test, when and why in cases of high hyperopia, and when the in case of astigmatism, where the pre-excess and post-midriatic are different, then it is better to do a PMT, and in cases of pseudomyopia. Then what and why to prescribe? Prescribing for pediatric refractive error is complex. It depends upon child's age, current refractive error, accommodative ability, degree of anisometropy, and ocular family history. And we follow the American Academy of Ophthalmology guidelines for glasses prescription. And for myopia, at less than age of 1 year, if it is more than 5, prescribe glasses. For age 1 to 2 years, more than 4, and for age 2 to 3 years, if it is more than 3, then we have to prescribe. And in hyperopia, this is 6, 5, and 4.50 for age less than 1 to 2, and 2 to 3 years respectively. And if there is esotropia, these values are reduced, and even at plus 2 diopter, you can give glasses. And for astigmatism also, it is better to prescribe after age of 3 to 4 years when it is more than 1.5 diopter. And with anisometropia also, these values vary. So we can see high myopes usually in syndromic, beside being common things, we can see in so many syndromic cases, in congenital stationary night blindness, Stickler syndrome, Stargardt and Guyrette. High hypermetropia is usually seen in LCA, nanophthalmos, cornea plana, and juvenile retinoschisis. And in CNLDO patient, usually we see more astigmatism in the myopia. Astigmatism is seen in congenital ptosis, hemangioma cases, dermoid, scarring, and lens dislocation. So various photo screeners are also available, but they are less reliable and they give false positive tests, so they are useful for screening purposes. But now we have approached to era of web-based test, and there are some web-based tests for older children, for more than 16 years, rather you say for adults. In cases of aphakia, glasses should be given, and later, after age of 2.5 years, bifocals can be given. Frequent refraction should be done. In pseudophakia, spectacle correction should be given for even smaller degrees of residual astigmatism, and bifocals are given in younger children, and progressive lenses are preferred. Special conditions are in esotropia with high AC by A ratio, where bifocals are prescribed, photochromatic for albinism and cone dystrophy cases, and for one-eyed children, it is useful to give protective carbonate glasses. So all refractive error, mostly myopia and myopic astigmatism, are in rise. And in 2020, we are having even more than 50 papers on refractive error and myopia and myopia epidemic. So pediatric ophthalmologists should be well versed with good retinoscopy so that they can do accurate retinoscopy and prescribe corrective glasses. So again, pediatric retinoscopy is an art. Learn it and enjoy it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Neelam, for that wonderful talk and highlighting on the difficulties with psychopentillate and all that also. We have seen two cases like that where the child had little altered this thing behavior. And we should be very careful to ask the history of seizures, which is usually denied by the parents. So it is very important we get that history. And one another thing is any astigmatism above 2.5, you think of in a slightly older child, like 9 years, 10 years, ask for history of eye rubbing and topography if needed has to be done. Thank you, Neelam, for that listening. We will now move on to the next talk by Dr. Veena. Dr. Veena has a marvelous journey of more than 17 years in pediatric ophthalmology. Besides being an excellent surgeon and a doctor, she is actively involved in pediatric refractive error screening programs. She has won the International ZOVA project and USAID projects using PLUS Optics. And she's done wonderful work with the teachers training program, which what we are doing, she changed to all class teachers model and has been published also. Welcome, Veena, for this talk and give your talk on AC by A ratio and its implications.
Thank you, Dr. Meenakshi, and your team for arranging a wonderful meeting. Good evening, all. Today, my talk will be on accommodative convergence, accommodation ratio, which is shortly called AC by A ratio, and its implications.
Full screen, please.
Okay. Can you see the screen?
Yeah, thank you.
Before going into topic per se, just to understand the physiology of accommodation, what is accommodation? It's a process by which the eye changes the optical power to maintain a clear image or focus on an object as its distance varies. As you all know, over the years, the accommodative power of the eye changes. What is convergence? It is a simultaneous inward deviation of both eyes. It is a disconjugate movement and it is due to the contraction of both medial rectus. There are two types, voluntary and involuntary. Involuntary, there are four types. For our interest, we will discuss only about accommodative convergence in this talk. What happens during accommodation? Before that, we will see the eye at rest. The eye at rest, the ciliary muscles are relaxed, the zonular fibers are under tension, and in unaccommodated lens will be flat. Whenever there is accommodation, when the eye accommodates from a far distance to see a near object, the ciliary muscle contracts, the zonules loosens and the lens moves forwards. The anterior posterior diameter of the lens increases, it relaxes. So this happens only under the age of 40, as you all know. When the lens becomes hard, this elasticity decreases and the accommodation of the lens reduces. So whenever we see a near object, apart from accommodation, there are two more things happening. That is constriction of the pupil, which is to increase the depth of focus, and the convergence of the eyeball, where the image forms in the corresponding points in the retina. So accommodation and convergence are linked together to work for near vision. So this is almost a fixed relationship. So at any given change in dioptric power of accommodation is a fixed change in accommodative convergence. So what is AC by ratio? It is the measurement of the convergence induced by accommodation per each diopter of accommodation. So what are we going to measure? We are going to determine the change in the accommodative convergence that occurs when the patient accommodates a given amount. Usually it is measured in prism diopters. The normal range is between 3 to 5 prism diopters. There are two types. Even though it's a fixed one, when we stimulate by changing the distance or by giving concave or convex lenses, the accommodation varies. It is called stimulus accommodation, and the response accommodation is to lenses or to the refractive errors. So our examination is based on the stimulus AC by A ratio. Usually stimulus AC by ratio is lesser than response AC by A ratio. There are 4 different methods which we can use to measure AC by ratio. For all practical purposes and for ease of using, I will be talking about only heterophoria method and the gradient method. Heterophoria method is a very simple method. It compares the measurement of deviation of the eyes using prisms and alternate cover test at distant fixation at 6 meters and near fixation at 33 centimeters with full refractive correction. And also we have to measure the interpupillary distance. Plus sign is used for exodeviation and minus sign is used for exodeviation. This is the formula. By using heterophoric method, interpupillary diopter diameter, interpupillary distance plus prisms, which is measured for near, minus prisms, the deviation for distance by the distance. Usually, if you are measuring at 33 centimeter, it is the 3 diopters, it's a fixed one, and 0 for distance. For example, IPD is 60 millimeter for this patient and has got 2 prisms of exophoria at distance and 10 prisms for exophoria for near at 40 centimeters. So AC by A ratio will be 6. It is measured, in centimeters. It is 6 plus 0.4 is the 40 centimeter and minus 10 is the distance measurement and minus 2 is the near measurement. And 2.8 is the AC by A ratio for this particular.
Any other implications?
I was using specs when I was doing my.
Excuse me, somebody's mic is on. Can you switch it off? Thank you. So for this particular patient, IPD is 56 millimeter and the patient is 3 prism exophoric at distance and 7 prism exophoric at near, that is at 40 centimeter. So his AC by ratio comes around 9.6, which is very high. Gradient method is changing the stimulus to accommodation, which is produced or induced by means of lenses. Concave lenses are placed in front of the eyes for measuring distance, which increases the requirement of accommodation. Convex lenses are used for near, and which is to relax the accommodation. Minus 1 diopter lens produces an equivalent of 1 diopter of accommodation, and plus 1 diopter of lens relaxes accommodation but 1 diopter. Just remember this. And we have to ask the patient to wear the corrective glasses, and then we have to add the lenses. For first we have to measure with optical correction and then with additional lenses for both distance and near. And This is distance minus near with optical correction and without optical correction by the distance which is measured in diopter. So what happens whenever there is abnormality of AC by ratio? Either it can be high AC by ratio, which can induce excessive convergence and convergence squint during when visualizing the near object. Low AC by ratio on reverse, it causes divergence squint when the patient looks at a near object. I will be explaining these two scenarios with a case presentation. First is a 7-year-old girl presents with a complaints of headache and eye strain with near work. Her unaided visual acuity was 20/20 in both eyes. At distance and near, the distance was deviation was ortho, and near she had 5 prism esophoria, and her IPD was 53 millimeter. So AC by ratio was 7.3, which is very high, and the patient was given +1 diopter. With +1 diopter, her fovea was only 2 prisms. So she was prescribed +1 diopter and review after 1 month. On review with glasses, she was so comfortable, no asthenopic symptoms, and her eyes were almost straight. There was no residual fovea. Case number 2, the boy presented with complaints of headache and eye strain for near work, and his unaided vision was 20/50 in both eyes. And cover test revealed near 2 prism exophoria and distance was 10, and his IPD was 54 millimeter. Refraction was, he was accepting -1.5, this is cycloplegic refraction in both eyes, and his AC by ratio was only 2.2, which is lower than normal. So he was given glasses, his corrective glasses, and review after 1 month. And what can we expect from him? His vision was clear, but he was not at all comfortable. Still symptomatic, headache and asthenopia was present. So whenever there is low AC by ratio, only prescribing optical prescription, optical correction will not be enough. We have to add on vision therapy or prism. So the uses of AC by ratio, it is used to diagnose squints and also differentiate many types of squints, and also used in therapies. In case of accommodative esotropia, where there is esotropia is more for near or only present in near, this test differentiates between other types of acquired esotropia and also helps in management, like giving bifocal glasses. Sometimes the child may not cooperate for prism measurement, but just taking an object at distance and near, even by the look itself, we can find out whether the child has got, because parents sometimes say the child has got squinting. But when the child walk into your cubicle, you may not observe any squinting. As soon as you take the target, immediately the child will squint. That gives the clue that there may be accommodative, the AC by ratio will be more, and which may need bifocal glasses. In case of exotropia, especially intermittent exotropia, there is a slow to dissipate fusional mechanism at near, which masks the true near deviation. So always we have to do a prolonged monocular occlusion, then measure AC by A ratio. And Kushner in his study has showed that the presence of high AC by ratio before surgery had high sensitivity and specificity and positive and negative predictive value of 100% for predicting a postoperative esotropia at near. So he insists on measuring AC by ratio after prolonged monocular occlusion in case of exotropic patient, especially intermittent exotropes. And Alien et al. Has in their study, they have observed that children who were treated for infantile esotropia, who underwent surgery, almost 60% of children who were operated for intermittent exotropia developed accommodative ET at the mean age of 33 months. So what they have concluded is increasing hypermetropia, that is moderate hypermetropia and delay in alignment and poor stereopsis pose a significant risk factor for accommodative esotropia. So they also insist the measuring the postoperative deviation and following it with measuring AC by A ratio is very, very important to manage early. And in case of myopia, all of us know that there is an elevated response AC by ratio is associated with increasing myopia, because they have proved that underlying anatomy, enlarged eye causes, there is a tension on the crystalline lens with the five zonules. And so there is a increased effort is needed to accommodate, which causes the elevated response to AC by A ratio. So to conclude, AC by A ratio is a very important investigation. It is, which is very, very simple to do, and we should do for almost all the squints. Whether we should not restrict ourselves to accommodative esotropes. So it's better to measure for all squints and also refractive errors. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, very much for going into details of accommodation and convergence. Thank you very much. Now our next speaker is Dr. Shashikant Shetty sir, and he will be talking on how much and when to prescribe plus in esotropias. Dr. Shashikant Shetty sir is head of department pediatric ophthalmology in Madurai, and sir has long glorious years, more than 20 years in pediatric ophthalmology and strabismus, and beside being a very excellent orator and academician, is actively involved in nystagmus management programs in various national and international forum. And he is, I cannot describe everything, he is having a long list of achievement. So he is an active member of UK nystagmus group. So over to you, sir, for the presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Neelam, for your very kind words. And I'd like to thank you and Dr. Meenakshi Madam for inviting me for this very exciting webinar. And I think your talk and Dr. Veena's talk made my talk very easy. And actually, I had very few slides. I thought now most of the slides were overlapping. So I'll just talk about how much and when to prescribe plus esotropias. So what we are talking, what is the introduction? But basically, when the hypermetropia is high, or is clinically, whether it is clinically significant, to how much we should prescribe, and what happens if you prescribe too much of hypermetropia, and how it affects emetropization, and what exactly is emetropization is the growth of the eyeball which occurs and makes the patient emetrope by the age of 8 to 9 years of age. So how these glasses, when you given earlier, affects the growth of the eyeball. So even they are noted that the growth of the eyeball is also affected in patients with preterm. Preterm children tend to develop some 6 to 6% of children develop hypermetropia. Not all of them develop myopia. Not all of them develop myopia. Some develop hypermetropia. And what is the level of hypermetropia which should be corrected in these patients? So what is emetropization? There's actually passive growth of the eyeball. When this eyeball grows, there are a lot of genetic factors which might be involved, like the familial factor. No, they might be, parents might be hypermetropic. So there may be some genes which might also cause the growth of the eyeball. And then is another factor called as active factors, which is required for the growth of the eyeball. So these active factors are what? They are the image blur. The image blur causes the eyeball to grow, okay? And excessive accommodation, that also plays a role in emetropization. So which is the age group where you see maximum changes in emetropization, no? When you prescribe glasses, so which are the age group which is very commonly affected? So most of the time, it's commonly in less than 1 year of age where you have the largest growth of the eyeball is occurring. And it can go up to age of 4 years where the active emetropization can occur and usually stops after the age of 4 years. So you will have some questions ki why we need to now correct the hypermetropia if it is going to affect the emetropization, the growth of the eyeball. So when we correct the hypermetropia, it actually reduces the developing accommodative esotropia. So all of us know accommodative esotropia is divided into refractive esotropia and accommodative non-refractive esotropia. Okay. And there is something called as convergence excess esotropia. Now, what is this accommodative refractive esotropia? Accommodative refractive esotropia means the patient will have hypometropia, and when you correct their hypometropia, the esotropia gets better. And what is accommodative non-refractive esotropia? So accommodative non-refractive esotropia means patient might be either a emetrope, patient might be a myope, or patient might be a hypermetrope. Okay. So, and they will also have an high AC by A.
We can't hear you, Dr. Shetty.
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. So when there is accommodative non-refractive esotropia, those patients will require their esotropia will be.
Dr. Shetty, your screen is not.
Screen is not shared.
Yeah. Please share again.
Okay, we had Can you see now?
No.
It's not seen.
And now only it is shot. Wait, it will come. It will not come. I started screen sharing, it is coming. Yes.
I'm a little unstable. It's seen now?
Yes. Please continue.
So when we correct the patients who have a risk of accommodative esotropia, who had hypermetropia of 4 diopters. So this was seen in infants. When they saw that the hypermetropia was large, more than around 4 diopters, so they had a high chance of developing accommodative esotropia. This hypermetropia, if you give them fully corrected hypermetropia correction, that also interferes with the emetropization. So what happens is when the image is very clear, the growth of the eyeball is affected. And also these patients tend to have, and patients who have very, children usually don't develop any symptoms because they have very large amplitudes of accommodation. So when they have very large amplitudes of accommodation, that usually corrects the hypermetropia and they usually don't manifest esotropia. So when patients are uncorrected, how it affects the child? One thing is it can develop into an esotropia, or usually the child may present with very poor performance in schools. They may have reduced writing skill, or they usually can have lower IQ, and then usually can have headaches. So the frontal headache is very common in patients who presents with, who have not, their hypermetropia has not been corrected. So patients who benefits with the hypermetropy correction are, you have to look into family history of accommodative esotropia. So children who have hypermetropia and not develop esotropia and have family history of accommodative esotropia, so those patients, the hypermetropia needs to be corrected. And if they have an abnormal binocular sensory function, a reduced stereo, low binocular, maybe suppression, so those hypermetropia need to be corrected. And if there is a significant anisometropia more than one diopter, if they have found that patients who had anisometropia of more than one diopter tended to develop esotropia more than the patients who didn't have anisometropia, in spite of having high hypermetropia. So these are the APOS guidelines. These are the rough guidelines because this has been put forward by clinicians. So it depends on the patient as well as depends on the clinician how you prescribe. So APOS recommended if there is more than 4 diopters of hypermetropia, this should be prescribed to children who don't have strabismus. If they have esotropia, then it needs to be corrected. Yeah, full hypermetropia minus the cyclopegic correction. And American Academy of You can hear me?
We can hear you, but we cannot see the screen.
You can hear me? Yeah, I got a very unstable internet connection actually.
Where are you presenting from?
At home.
Oh, okay.
American Academy of Ophthalmology actually recommended more than plus 6 diopter if up to 1 year of age. If it is more than 5 diopters from 1 to 2 years of age, and if it is more than 4.5 diopters, 2 to 3 years of age. So accommodative esotropia is most common. As I told you, that accommodative esotropia may present in patients who have high hyperopia, and it can present from 6 months to 7 years of age. Many of them may have family history of esotropia or may have family members wearing hyperopic correction. They usually have normal AC by ratio. Accommodative refractive esotropia will have a normal AC by ratio, where accommodative non-refractive esotropia will have an high AC by ratio. So, and the papers we found that many of them had an average hyperopia of plus 4 diopters. And we need to prescribe full cycloplegic correction in these patients. And as Burton Bushnell puts it, we need to review the patient regularly, check their binocular vision, check their visual acuity. And depending on that, the plus correction can be slowly reduced to make the patient towards emetropization. And as Dr. Veena has put it correctly, there was a paper by Dr. Ellen Bridge, which looked at patients of infantile esotropia were corrected, and they noted the patient developing esotropia after 36 months of the primary surgery. And they found many of these patients had a residual deviation, had a high, have a medium hypermetropia, and had a high AC by ratio. So this, and 60% of their patients developed esotropia. So even if they had a low hyperopia, so the authors recommended that this patient should be given hyperopic correction. So this was a paper where they looked into infantile esotropia developing accommodative esotropia. So there was a delay in alignment, had a large residual esotropia which was persisting for 3 to 4 months, had a poor stereo, and an increasing hyperopia, which pushed them towards developing accommodative esotropia. So as Dr. Veena has put it, we have the gradient method and the heterophoric method. Both are stimulus-related AC by ratio. What do you mean by stimulus? Stimulus means you give the stimulus and the patient responds by accommodation. So when he accommodates, he converges. So now that depends on the child, how much he converges for the amount of the stimulus. So you might record the AC by ratio low, or maybe low means it is higher, but it's less. And when you give them treatment, you still have a residual esotropia. Have a residual esotropia in spite of giving them bifocals. So they usually have a high AC by ratio, and usually Dr. Kushner recommends when we check exotropia, you use the gradient method. Okay, use the gradient method for distance. And in patients with true divergence exotropia, and in patients who have a accommodative non-refractive esotropia with high AC by ratio, he recommends heterophoric method. And the recommendations are to give them inverted D bifocals and not to use progressive bifocals, because when we use a progressive bifocals, the part of the hyperopia which is highest is at the lower down. And patient may not use the lower part of the progressive. And what Kushner recommend is you try with plus 2.5 diopters, because if you give them plus 3 diopters, you actually make them myopic for near. And so, and the patient may not look through the lower segment of the bifocal. He might look at through the upper segment. So you give them less 2.5, you give them lower hyperopes, and then you slowly increase the hyperopia depending on the amount of deviation. So you make the patients microtropic so that the patient may develop some amount of binocular vision. And each visit, you check their deviation and you check their fusional divergence. Okay, so fusional divergence is very important. If they have good fusional divergence and they have an AC by ratio, you negate the AC by ratio by the fusional divergence, and then you undercorrect the amount of hyperopia which we are given in the bifocals. And as the patient grows older, you keep checking the deviation, because according to Kushner, the AC by ratio reduces as the child reaches 17 to 18 years of age. So you don't reduce the bifocals, slowly reduce, don't remove the bifocals, slowly reduce depending on the deviation, fusional divergence, and AC by ratio. And we invite all of you for our next webinar on surgical decoding. And these are a lot of experts. You can see in the screen from Dr. Richard Hertel, who will be moderating the session, with Dr. Serafino from Italy, and Dr. Maria from Moorfields, Dr. Cowell from Melbourne. They'll be talking on next Saturday. We'll be talking on surgically decoding the nystagmus, and followed by a case presentation by our fellow. We hope to see you, all of you, there for the next webinar on Saturday 5th at 6:30 Indian Standard Time. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your nice presentation, and thank you for invitation for this nystagmus decoded. We'll go on for next presentation by Dr. Shashikala from Coimbatore, minus lenses for exotropia. Dr. Shashikala is consultant at Irvine Eye Hospital, Coimbatore, and she has vast surgical experience both in pediatric strabismus, and she has presented and published various articles in international journals and national journals, and she was also speaker for various pediatric and neuro-ophthalmology conferences. So over to Dr. Shashikala.
Full screen. Yeah. Shashikala, we cannot hear you. Shashikala, we cannot hear you. Yeah, Shashikala, please start. Yes, ma'am. We cannot hear you, Shashikala. You have to unmute. Anga mute panirukanga, ma'am, Madurai. Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, now can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
A very good afternoon to all. I thank the organizing team for giving me this opportunity, and thank you for your kind words. We are coming to the last topic for the pediatric refraction potpourri. So for the next few minutes, we'll have a discussion why minus lenses are preferred for exotropia. What is the role for minus lenses for exotropia? So the treatment decision for intermittent exotropia is still a challenge, and the timing and methods for intervention are controversial. We treat the patient whenever the patient is symptomatic and when his binocular vision is impaired. And our objective for treatment in intermittent exotropia is to reduce the angle of deviation and to enhance the ability to control the deviation. So the two arms for management strategies include the non-surgical and the surgical. Surgical, including the extraocular muscle surgeries and botulinum toxin. Our concern is now with the non-surgical methods. So the options are to observe the child with intermittent exotropia, go for patching, occlusion therapy, prism therapy, orthoptics, binocular vision therapy, and over minus lens therapy. So when do we plan to manage a child with intermittent exotropia in a conservative management when we are uncertain of the surgical results, especially when we are operating, planning for managing a child with intermittent exotropia very young age, when we are not able to get a proper orthoptic evaluation, when uncertainty about the surgical result, whether it will result in overcorrection or simultaneously when we are following up, sometimes we end up having repeated increase in the deviations. So then we plan to manage the child conservatively. So the options, prisms is an option, but the issues are it's inappropriate for larger angle of deviation and interferes with visual acuity. With orthoptic exercise, the issues are children are need cooperation more understanding is required about the orthoptic. It's difficult for them to perform, especially in younger children, to understand and do it. Patching therapy, again, the issues are cosmetic concerns and compliance. O minus classes, the positive things are it's a cosmetically acceptable means and it doesn't interfere much with the visual acuity, especially in young children, though in older children, astenopic symptoms are commonly seen and children are sufficiently compliant for glasses wear in the daytime. So how does this O minus glasses work? They work through two mechanisms that has been proposed. One is the accommodative convergence mechanism, where O minus glasses stimulates the child's accommodative convergence. Thereby, they control the divergent angle of deviation and reduce intermittent exotropia. The other mechanism is the fusional convergence mechanism, where researchers have found the role of disparity-induced vergence in controlling intermittent exotropia. So O-minus lenses promote fusional convergence at near. They clear the blur that is at distance. And also, O-minus lenses stimulate convergence accommodation, thus reduce the deviation. So the next part, whom to prefer O-minus glasses. So whenever we have intermittent exotropia, mostly of a distant variant, and who require treatment and to prevent the loss of binocular functions, where we want to improve cosmesis and reduce the angle of deviation, where the Newcastle score is more than 3, and when there is decompensation of deviation, we can prefer a non-surgical method of O-minus glasses. So whom do we not prefer O-minus glasses? So especially in children who have earlier been treated with minus 1 or minus 1.5 over minus glasses or failed for other non-surgical modalities for intermittent exotropia, who have had previous strabismus surgery or who have an associated vertical deviation, who has been treated for cataract, retinal pathologies or any reasons that has caused reducing best corrected visual acuity. So when we decide to start on what all to evaluate, first about the history, so detailed history about the age of onset, any other family history related, any other associations, and how is the control. So control at home, questions regarding that is very much important for us to know whether it is obvious deviations, whether there is eye squeezing, closing of eye for when they are at home, and how frequently during the daytime the child has deviations. Then when we start assessing, start with the stereo acuity assessment at near fixation using Frisby or TNO charts. Uniocular visual acuity at distance for the age appropriate methods, with the age appropriate methods. Look for the corneal reflex, and in the cover test, when we do for distance and near, which will help us to score for the Newcastle score method, look for the rate of recovery, look for whether they are fusing spontaneously or fusing after a blink or refixating after a blink, or they remain dissociated even after cover has been removed. So this is the Newcastle control score method, where home control has 0 to 3 grading. 0 means the squint or monocular eye closure has never been noticed at home. 1 is more than less than 50% of the daytime child has squinting or monocular eye closure, and it is seen, so it's seen occasionally. And score 2, more than 50% of hours when they are noted at home for distance, the child is squinting or monocular eye closure. Score 3, squint and monocular eye closure is seen for distance and near fixation. Clinic control, same 0 for distance and near means manifest only after cover test and resumes fixation without the need for blink or refixation. Similarly, 1 is blink or refixates to control after cover test. 2 for manifest spontaneously or with an with any form of fusional disruption without recovery. So the other evaluations include ocular motility assessment, baseline positive and negative fusional vergence, prism cover test, ACVA ratio, preferably the lens gradient method, cycloplegic refraction to determine the refractive error for the child, and of course fundus and media evaluation to rule out any other associated problems. So once we've evaluated the child, now how to go about prescribing, how much to prescribe. So there are two approaches. So we can have a fixed amount of over minus that is based on the child's refractive error or the age, or select an initial amount of over minus and then slowly increase incrementally to a certain level that will control the intermittent exotropia. Studies have shown that safely over minus can be given between somewhere between minus 0.50 diopter to minus 5 diopters. The other points to consider and keep in mind when we prescribe over minus glasses is this prescription of minus glasses should be the minimum that will reduce the angle of deviation at distance and should allow control of deviation to an exophoria both at distance and near. It should be tolerated by the child because they have to wear full waking hours and the distance visual acuity should not be compromised. The correction should be given over the existing myopic or astigmatism correction. In cases of hyperopia, if it is a mild hyperopia, no need to give hypermetropic correction. We can directly give over minus. If it's more than that, then we can plan to reduce minus 1 from the existing refraction from the hypermetropic cover. So when we have prescribed glasses now, what all to assess when they come for review? So there are two assessment methods for over minus. One is the Newcastle score method. The other one is the Kalrich and Jampolsky's method, which includes a qualitative and a quantitative change. So a qualitative change means how much the child ability has improved from poor to good. Quantitative is how much it is reduced. So a reduction of 15 prism diopter is expected when we follow them with the over minus therapy. So a classification of no change or no result is made whenever there is a manifest exotropia, even after wearing minus glasses, even if the ability to control has improved. So when we prescribe over minus, when all to follow up. So as soon as the over minus is given, the first 3 weeks or 4 weeks are important. We need to follow them up at the 3 to 4 weeks to see for any overcorrection or undercorrection. So then the child is followed up for the first 6 months with the over minus glasses. So in this follow-up period, if there is any, we need to increase the over minus if there is any deterioration in the binocularity, and if there is esotropia for near, we need to reduce the minus. So once 6 months is completed and then child's control has improved and the deviation also has reduced, then over the next 1 to 2 years, we can have a period of reducing lenses where every 6 months when they are followed up after the evaluation and the scoring, a 0.5 reduction can be made and the child can be reduced from the glasses. So after a certain period of time, then we can totally wean off the glasses if the child is able to control the strabismus even after weaning the glasses. So after weaning the glasses, after cessation of the minus lenses, they should be followed up closely for 6 months. So during the follow-up period of any of these phases, if the child has a deteriorating binocularity or increasing in the distance deviation, we need to plan for a surgical option. So over minus glasses can definitely improve the control for intermittent exotropia and result in no manifest tropia. It can result in reduction in the Newcastle score. It can also have older children especially, they can complain of astenopic symptoms like headache, blur, eye strain and avoidance for near work. So dosage of minus 1 to minus 3, most of the studies have said it is a well tolerated power. So the other concern that many of the practicing clinicians have is, do overcorrecting minus lenses result in myopia? So the same question was put forward like in hypothesis by Dr. Kushner. So in his publication in Archives of Ophthalmology 1999, so he wanted to see whether excessive accommodation has been implicated as a cause of myopia, because theoretical concerns are there that over minus lenses can cause myopia. So in his study, we can that clearly he's mentioned that over minus lens therapy does not result in myopia. Myopia that results in IXTs is because of the emetropization process, not pertaining to over minus therapy. So I just want to go through few prospective studies which have analyzed the benefits of over minus glasses. So the first one is published in Ophthalmology 2016. This is a randomized trial evaluating short term, that is 6 week follow up, 8 week follow up after a over minus therapy that was given for age group between 3 to 6. So this first study, so they have done it as a pilot study from the National Eye Institute. They had seen 8 weeks response after over minus therapy in the age group of 3 to 6 years. So in this study, they have enrolled and randomized children between over minus groups and observation group. Over minus group directly received a fixed minus 2.50 over minus over their spectacle corrections of myopia or hyperopia. And the observation group, they received their own spectacles. There was no over minus over their spectacles, or some with the emetropia did not receive spectacles. And after 8 weeks, the control was assessed. They used the Mooney and Holmes control score. So the eligibility criteria was the age of 3 to 6 years. The children should have a distance control score of more than 2, near control equivalent to 5, and a deviation for distance should be more than 15, and near deviation should not be more than 10 from the distance. And they also excluded using these criteria. So in that study, they had 58 children who where 31 were put on observation without the over minus. Children had over minus of minus 2.50 diopter. So in end of 8 weeks, this is the report that they have said that 59% with the over minus had responded, that is more than 1 line improvement in 8 weeks, and 39% without any over minus had responded with a 1 line improvement. So based on this, they have gone forward with a randomized clinical trial. In this long term, they have included on treatment and off treatment. Off treatment is what I told you about weaning of glasses. So long term effects on treatment effect. So that's the primary outcome, and the secondary outcome they are looking is off treatment effect of over minus glasses on the distance intermittent exotropia control score following weaning and 3 months off treatment. So this study is still ongoing. They have planning to enroll 384. So study is planned to probably get in by 2020. So this is one prospective study which is under now for both looking into on treatment and off treatment reports about positive over minus glasses. The other study that is published is a UK study done in UK, published in I. So here Rowe et al, they've looked into intervention for intermittent distant exotropia with over minus glasses. So here they have treated as over minus glasses as the primary treatment for intermittent distant exotropia. They wanted to look into the alignment after 5 years of starting the study. So this is a prospective study where they have enrolled 21 children with intermittent distant exotropia. So here minimum minus what the child requires to control the manifest deviation was given, and the strength of lenses was reduced. So here they have studied both on treatment and off treatment reports of over minus. So the results is that they have found with the treatment, angle of reduction was good, and overcorrecting lenses, they did not appear to induce myopia, supporting Kushner's reports. And 24% off treatment, when they followed up end of 5 years, 24% had a successful outcome. That is, they had a good control, not noted any phoria, and 28% had a good control. At sometimes distance phoria was noted, and 33% required surgery at a later date. So they are non-responders for the therapy. So they concluded that this 52 good and successful response was seen, and they maintained the same results over the 1 year of follow-up. And the remaining 33% who required surgery were operated only after 8 years. So, and they had a positive experience of binocularity. So the outcome of surgery with a single surgery, and it was outcome was good. So these children were not been able to wean off the plus lenses also. So they had that over minus glasses can be a primary option for intermittent distant exotropia, but we'll have to keep in mind that surgery might be required, and because of this over minus glasses, surgery can be delayed to an older age without any prior loss of binocularity. So the third study is a study from South India. So that's been published in 2018. They studied the role of over minus therapy in intermittent exotropia. So here only the treatment phase has been studied for 1 year duration of time. So they evaluated using the Newcastle score, the angle of deviation after a trial of over minus 6 months and 1 year. So they had 53 children, and their results, they had studied between age of 1 to 5. So they have included very young children, so they won't face problems of asthenopia and non-compliance with the older children. So at 1 year end of the study, 27 had the same baseline value as the initial, and 32% had 1 line reduction. This is with the over minus glasses, and 21 had 2 line score reduction, and 5% had 3 point score reduction from the baseline. The angle of deviation for both distance and near had shown significant reduction. So they had found that improvement in IXT with the over minus glasses, and trial can be given in children less than 5 years of age. So this article, when I was going through the topic, I found it's a very recently published article in the Journal of Current Ophthalmology, which discusses in detail about all the non-surgical methods published in August, September issue. So here they have mentioned among all the studies about non-surgical methods, three studies, prospective studies they have mentioned, and all three studies have only reported on the treatment phase. So the weaning off phase, the off treatment phase, there are very less studies which has been mentioned. So the other two studies I have already discussed earlier. So the second one, Biramal studied only 19 patients. So they also found that it was a there was improvement in the patient's control. So to conclude, so O-minus lenses for exotropia, it is an encouraging non-surgical option. We can as a trial for intermittent distant exotropia, especially in younger children, and we are planning to delay the surgery so that we can have positive effects on the biomarker. Excuse me, somebody's. And preferable prescription could be between -1 to -3. Strict compliance and follow-up is required. Short-term reports on treatment have evidence providing good binocularity with asymptomatic control of deviations, but long-term off-treatment control is yet to be ascertained. So we need to keep in mind treatment lesser response of non-responsive children with over minus also could exist. So, yeah. Thank you so much. Yeah, these are my reference.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Shashikala, for detailed minus lens therapy and all studies related to lens therapy in exotropias. So with all plus and minuses, finishing all these, we will move to next session on cutting edge amblyopia management. And Dr. Ankita Bisani, she will be presenting on drugs or patching. Dr. Ankita Bisani has done her DNB and pediatric fellowship from Arvind Eye Hospital, Tirunelveli, and currently she is consultant at pediatric department in Arvind Eye Hospital, Chennai. And she has, to her credit, various national and international presentations. So over to Dr. Ankita.
Good evening, everyone. Yes, ma'am. My topic for today is patching or drugs in amblyopia. With an obvious answer in mind, let us proceed to the discussion. A lot has been discussed about amblyopia and plasticity of brain. Amblyopia is usually caused by abnormal brain stimulation during the critical periods of visual development and the so-called plastic period. Plasticity basically refers to the dynamic ability of the brain to reorganize its functional and structural connections in response to environmental changes. This period usually lasts from birth to 7 to 8 years of age, and after which the plasticity is dramatically reduced. The basic principles of managing amblyopia is first to remove all the organic causes which block vision, then prescribe optimum refractive correction and give us some time for refractive adaptation, which is about 18 to 22 weeks. And further, after which, if the visual acuity does not improve, then we go to other therapies like occlusion, penalization, or other therapies included in amblyopia. Coming to occlusion therapy, it is the gold standard in treatment of amblyopia. It usually prevents the fixing eye from taking part in act of vision, so that patient is forced to use the amblyopic eye, and it removes the inhibitory stimuli of the fixing eye on the amblyopic eye. Practical reason, including patient's acceptance, compliance rate, and improvement rate of improvement, full occlusion is usually started in early infancy. The maximum age for attempting treatment is still an unresolved question, and I think Dr. Frederick sir will throw some light on this. The American Academy of Ophthalmology now recommends that an attempt at treatment should be offered to all amblyopic children, regardless of age, including those in later childhood. We all know there are a lot of occluders are available in the market. The most commonly used ones are the adhesive skin patches. These can be self-made with micropore as well. That there are a lot of the types of occlusion therapy which all of us are familiar with. They are the total or partial, conventional or inverse, full-time or part-time. Full-time is occlusion during all waking hours, part-time is occlusion 2 to 6 hours per day, and inverse occlusion, which is patching off the amblyopic eye in case of eccentric fixation. There has been a debate about part-time versus full-time occlusion. Part-time occlusion predicts states that 2 hours of daily patching is as effective as 6 hours of
For moderate amblyopia and for severe amblyopia, 6 hours of prescribed daily patching is just as effective as full-time patching. But a lot other more studies have shown that full-time occlusion produced excellent visual acuity results, and it has been supported by various studies. Majority of pediatric ophthalmologists have not altered their practice of full-time patching despite the recommendation of ATS and PEDIC, fearing poor visual outcomes with reduced patching hours. There has been a lot of debate about near, including near activity during occlusion therapy. A pilot study done by PEDIC had suggested that there was a greater improvement in amblyopic eye in a group which performed a lot of near visual activities in comparison to the non-near activities group. But a later study by the same authors, with a larger number of amblyopes, had not shown improvement in visual outcome with near activities. But still, a lot of us recommend near activities at least a few hours in our occlusion therapy. Follow-up in occlusion therapy is very important. The frequency includes frequency is usually related to the age. Younger the patient, the greater the risk of occlusion amblyopia. At least 1 week for every year of age is the recommended criteria. Monitoring parameters include visual acuity, fixation pattern, and presence of occlusion amblyopia. And when to terminate? When the visual acuity is equal in both eyes, there is true alternation of fixation and no visual improvement after 3 to 6 months of occlusion despite good compliance. Method for termination of occlusion therapy is very important because it can lead to recurrence of amblyopia. The risk factors for recurrence are abrupt therapy cessation, cessation before the age of 10 years, and strabismic amblyopia. So it is highly recommended that the treatment intensity should be tapered to a maintenance therapy, and they have to be monitored for at least a year up to 12 years of age. And it has been well supported by the PEDIC trials. Compliance is very important in occlusion therapy. To study the compliance, a lot of studies had used occlusion dose monitors, and they have confirmed that not all children and parents comply well with patching. Hence, patching hours prescribed are often not equal to the actual dose of patching. The monitored and randomized occlusion treatment of amblyopia studies showed that the compliance with patching treatment was less than 50%. What are the barriers to compliance? The barriers to compliance include uncertainty about the treatment, distress in the child, patient's age, social deprivation, level of visual acuity before starting occlusion therapy, and parental understanding of the condition. Disadvantages include occlusion amblyopia and may need a child with poor vision, severe amblyopia may need supervision to accidental injuries, non-compliance to therapy, cosmetically unacceptable to some, psychological problems, allergic skin rashes, diplopia, and increase in angle of deviation. Atropine penalization is a well-established treatment. Optically defocuses the non-amblyopic eye by paralyzing the ciliary muscle, and patient's acceptance to atropine penalization was superior to that of patching, and compliance with atropine treatment could be readily checked by inspection. It was found that occlusion therapy was very much comparable to atropine penalization by PEDIC group of investigators. They found that daily 1% atropine drop in 3 to 7 years of children with moderate amblyopia had shown similar visual acuity magnitude of improvement as compared to occlusion. A lot of studies have also confirmed that daily dose is equally the weekly dose is equally good as compared to daily doses of atropine drops. The advantages of atropine penalization is that it is better tolerated, cosmetically better acceptable, and induces a forced compliance. Once the drug is instilled, poses a less emotional distress to the child and the family, and it is easy to inspect. Though atropine has equivalent outcomes to patching, it still remains a secondary option in clinical setting. It has certain side effects. They are dry mouth, tachycardia, delirium, photophobia, ocular pain, headache, facial flushing, lowered seizure threshold, and have to be used very cautiously. So to conclude about atropine penalization and occlusion is, in cases where we correct the refractive error and there is resolution of amblyopia after continuing with glasses, then there is no occlusion or penalization therapy required, and patient has to be on regular follow-up. If there is moderate amblyopia, then occlusion 2 to 6 hours per day is done with a maintenance with penalization and follow-up. Severe amblyopia may require higher hours of occlusion, up to 6 to 12 hours, then maintenance with penalization and occlusion therapy, and they have to be followed up. Coming to drugs, the conventional occlusion therapy for amblyopia is found often incomplete, as many patients were left with some amount of permanent reduction in visual acuity despite maintaining adequate compliance. The phenomenon of binocular competition has been shown to be dependent on a lot of neurotransmitters and neuromodulators in the brain. Based on this, certain drugs have been tried in amblyopia: levodopa-carbidopa combination, citicolin, fluoxetine, and GABA antagonists. Dopamine has been known to play an important role in retinal function and in central visual processing. Dopamine improves the expression of NMDA receptor 1 subunit in the visual cortex, which in turn regulates the plasticity during the critical and adult period. It has shown to improve the VEP response. Dopamine, released by a unique set of amacrine cells, activates D1 and D2 dopamine receptors distributed throughout the retina, where it plays a chemical messenger for light adaptation and multiple trophic capabilities. It has shown to improve the ERG B wave amplitude. Why levodopa-carbidopa is used in combination is because levodopa is a precursor of dopamine and easily crosses the blood-brain barrier. Carbidopa is a peripheral decarboxylase inhibitor, which prevents the peripheral conversion of levodopa into dopamine, and thereby it increases the availability of dopamine to the central nervous system and allowing the reduction of dose to about 75%. To my surprise, there were about 20 trials in levodopa so far. I'll just quote a few latest ones done. Some have shown promising results and some have shown vice versa. Latest trial by the pedic investigators in children aged 7 to 12 years with daily levodopa carbidopa, in addition to continued 2 hours of patching, showed no clinically significant improvement in visual acuity. Another trial, which is slightly larger subjects, they had shown otherwise, that they had shown statistically significant visual gains sustained at 1 year of follow-up. Various doses have so far been tried for levodopa. Some studies have used lower doses of 1.5 milligram per kg per day, while others used higher ones from about 6 to 13 milligram per kg per day. Side effects include headache, nausea, dry mouth, lowering of body temperature, and abdominal cramps. With the review of literature in levodopa, it is to conclude that a direct comparison of all the studies is not possible, as different studies have used different designs, different age groups, type and severity of amblyopia, and prior intervention, duration of follow-up. So most of the studies were not double blind. They used limited number of patients with relatively short follow-up. An effect of levodopa on amblyopia is temporary, since there is no consensus about the dose duration of levodopa therapy in amblyopic patients. Another promising drug was citicolin. It has shown to increase the level of norepinephrine and dopamine levels in the CNS, offering neuroprotection in hypoxic and ischemic condition. It has shown to inhibit apoptosis in neurodegenerative models and thereby potentiating neuroplasticity. It is a well-tolerated drug with less significant systemic cholinergic side effects, but some side effects include insomnia, headache, diarrhea, low or high blood pressure, and nausea. A lot of trials have shown promising results. They showed improvement in visual acuity, contrast sensitivity, and VEP amplitudes in both normal and in amblyopic eye. Most of the trials showed that these improvements remain stable for at least 4 months after stopping the treatment. Some other drugs like fluoxetine, which is a selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor, has been used in animal models and have shown promising results in amblyopia treatment. Similarly, GABA antagonists like bicuculin have also showed promising results in animal models, but they are all still in experimental stage. To conclude, occlusion therapy is replete with well-designed, prospective, controlled clinical trials to demonstrate both the efficacy and limitation. Patching is currently the preferred treatment option among most of the ophthalmologists, and atropine penalization has been equivalent for moderate and severe amblyopia. But most of the drugs are still in experimental stage, except levodopa, carbidopa, which has been explored as an adjunct to conventional therapy and not the primary line of treatment. Medical therapy in isolation or in addition to conventional therapy is still in its infancy, and potential agents are in research and developmental stage yet. So we have winner occlusion therapy. Thank you.
Thank you, Ankita, for going through all details of drug therapy in amblyopia. So right now we'll move to next presentation. Last presentation, Dr. Frederick, he had some medical emergency, so he will not be able to join us today. Probably he will join us tomorrow. So moving to next and last presentation, Dr. Satya, she will be speaking on computer-based therapies for amblyopia. Dr. Satya is consultant in pediatric department for more than 6 years, and currently she is in Arvind Tirupati, and she was recipient of Dr. G. Venkat Swami Gold Award in 2010 for MS, and she is a wonderful surgeon, and she had been wet lab instructor in ASCRS. Over to Dr. Satya for computer-based therapies for amblyopia.
Thank you, Meenakshi ma'am and Dr. Neelam, for this opportunity. Am I audible?
Yes.
I'm going to be talking about computer-based amblyopia therapy. And as technology has taken over almost all aspects of our life, so has it in a lot of these different amblyopia therapies. Even in the gold standard patching and occlusion therapy that Ankita was talking about, technology has also come here. This is the amblyozyme. So this is a liquid crystal glass. So the child is instructed to wear it throughout the daytime, and it can be recharged in the night. So what happens is these liquid crystals over this glass can turn opaque. So the child is unaware when the patching is started, and even during binocular viewing, it can lower the contrast on the normal eye, thus stimulating the amblyopic eye to see. Because of the cost, this has not become very popular. So the CAM simulator works on the principle that gratings of different spatial acuity can stimulate motion sensitive cells and indirectly form sense and therefore improve amblyopia. So what they have tried is to create video games with a background of these grating acuities, so that while the child is playing, this grating is unknowingly stimulating the cortical neurons. So as Anita just mentioned, we're talking about a lot of encouraging mirror activity when we do patching. So we tell the child to color, to draw, but definitely every day to do this is going to be difficult. And the easiest way to tempt them to do this is to try video games. And it has also been proven by neurophysiological studies that video games can stimulate the and alter the neurological neuromodulatory pathway. So this is a better way to stimulate children. So what I usually advise is that at the end of their prescribed patching schedule, they must be allowed around 20 to 30 minutes of this playtime, and not to give the child any of these video games at any other time. This is also to motivate them to do the patching, and also will work to improve near vision. So now there are other more scientific activities and different softwares available for encouraging near activity. And the one here is the Amblyopia iNet. You can see on this, there are 12 games available. So we choose which eye that the child has amblyopic. So the software has an artificial intelligence based on which it can alter the contrast, the form sense which the child sees. So the entire program can be done monocularly with one eye patched, or with a binocular field where only the amblyopic eye gets stimulated. So they start at a certain visual acuity, which means the target object is at a certain size. And over time, it slowly reduces so that the target object comes down at 6. Perceptual learning is a newer concept. And this is kind of says that with practice, it is not that there is no plasticity in adults. The plasticity is better in children, but even in adults, amblyopia can be recovered to a certain extent, can be reversed. So what is done is that the person is asked to look at these kind of contrasts, which they call as plans. And they call it gabor patches. So what happens is when they keep on looking at these things and keep have to clicking. So when they click the right contrast, they get an auditory feedback. So 40 minute sessions, thrice a week, over 40 sessions, they say that the person improves. Revital Vision is one of these organizations that offer this technology. But most of studies have shown that this kind of increases better contrast and stereopsis, but hasn't shown much improvement with visual acuity. So all of these were about monocular treatment with the eye occluded. Moving beyond monocular therapy, when we do all of this patching, what happens is only the amblyopic eye is being excited. So the sensory eye dominance remains the same. With binocular therapy, you will both be exciting the amblyopic eye and inhibiting the dominant eye. So what we would be doing is making the weaker eye less weak and the stronger eye less strong. So thus stimulating better binocular vision. So all of this active visual therapy that I will be talking about is based on perceptual learning, dichroptic stimulation, and binocular training with animated classes, especially in the virtual reality games. So this is an example of the common brick game, the Tetris game they call it, that you play with the red and cyan glasses. So you can see when you see through the red, the blue disappears. When you see through the blue, the red disappears. So the child needs to be visualizing with both eyes to be seeing this. But you can see that when seeing through the blue glasses, the red is faintly still visible. So unless you set the contrast correctly, this will not work. So there are a lot of games available on the Play Store and red-blue glasses that you can buy on Amazon. I'm surprised to find over 60 glasses that you can buy. But the problem with all of these is that unless you match it to the right contrast, it will not work. It will not serve the purpose. So there are, again, a lot of softwares that have been designed with a scientific basis so that you can have different games and also measure the child's improvement, the amount of time that they do patching. So AmblioPlay, CureSight are one such thing. So again, they can do either with occlusion or use the red-blue glasses for different versions of it. So they can also have like a telemedicine feedback with the consultant or with the orthoptist who can guide them on which games to be playing for longer or what the child needs more. So Binox is what we have at Aravind Madurai. And again, we offer both office therapy and home-based therapy. So for home-based therapy, we give it a username password so the child can use it at home. But the glasses have to be specific that the company gives. So that is what is very important, having the right red-blue glasses. So what does literature have to say about all of these exercises? So I have taken a few studies, most of which are RCTs. So this one is an RCT done with children, 385 children, and it was eye pad versus patching. And the falling brick game was used. What they said was both improved, but patching was better. In adults, this is a study that compared with a binocular video game and a placebo game. A placebo game means both eyes saw the same image. So what they found was that it did not really work well. But this, they attributed it to the fact that the brick game is not captivating and they had to play for 1 hour every day. So this is another study which tried a more active game. So this was done on children and they call this the gold mining game. So they have these little miners in red and they have to dig it. You can see the very faint blue gold that you see there. So the child has to take the red figure there and then keep digging till they get out the blue. So they score points based on this. They found that in 2 weeks, this game was better than patching in improvement, but over time, over at a 4 week visit, they were both equal. So to make games much more interesting, virtual reality comes into play. So again, multiple companies offer Luminopia, Vivid Vision, and Remed, some things that I found online. So what they do is create two different images in both eyes. So Anagin is having two different stereoptic images. You can see that the color contrast is different and there's a slight horizontal disparity. So what this allows is that gives a low contrast eye to the normal eye and a higher contrast to the amblyopic eye. And you can see that some of the target is, which is seen in one eye is not seen in the other eye. So the both eyes are stimulated to see together to pick on these organs. And they also have different versions of this, which again improve on depth perception. So this is one where they can use their own hand into the game. They can see their hand come into the game. And they have to pick on the one that has a certain amount of depth. So again, you can see the horizontal disparity on this one. So a lot of studies are available. So these are two meta-analyses that came out in 2020, just this year. So the reason I'm presenting here is what they have found after looking at over thousands of such articles. This one says that there are only 23 articles that they could take for analysis. And in this article, which was specific for anisometropic amblyopia, they analyzed 8 articles. And what they have to say is that binocular therapy is one of the most important developments in the field of amblyopia, but there is limited scientific literature with high levels of quality and that we need to do further such RCTs. So they say it cannot replace patching, but can be recommended along with patching. So in conclusion, I would like to say it's surprising how this hasn't caught on much. You know, amblyopia after all begins with using binocularity. So when we're doing occlusion, we're not doing anything for the binocularity. So it makes sense that we use this therapy as an adjunct to patching. Probably when we have child has recurred vision to better than 6/12. So instead of tapering patching, it would make sense to give binocular stimulation. So that would also prevent reversal and going back into amblyopia. In strabismus, it would not be recommended. A few of the studies have said that after surgery, when there's a residual squint of within 10 to 12 prisms, we can give these exercises to improve binocular vision. But in a higher strabismus, some of these games offer where you can deviate the second image and then again, you can play the same games, but the problem is you could be creating an intractable diplopia. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you, Satya, for very nice pictorial illustrations of all images and video games. So now we can take questions.
Question from actually Dr. Shetty. But Sachikala, you would like to answer that from the chat? Or Sandra, because we Coimbatore is using minus lenses therapy. Sandra, are you there? Dr. Sachikala, can you hear us? Coimbatore? Sandra, we cannot hear you.
Ma'am, are you able to hear me?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, I'm sorry for there was a problem with the mic. To answer his question, actually we are prescribing for less than 5 year age group. But I can't remember a particular case with two divergent sexes. So we don't have personal experience in prescribing for a child with two divergent sexes. Though in the study, they have said that they can prescribe and they would be a good candidate for prescription of minus lenses, according to the study. Dr. Shetty, like to add some more on this question.
Yeah, actually, basically for, we should avoid actually for prescribing for all intermittent XTs, unless you have a true divergence excess and who have a high AC by ratio by gradient method. And if they show a very high AC by ratio and there is no family history of myopia and there is no history of prematurity, I think then minus lenses can be safely given. Because we had a patient who was given minus lens, he developed consecutive ASO deviation without a surgical correction. So many of these patients over a period of time, you need to monitor. I have a patient who I have been monitoring since 7 years. And the patient we had given and patient developed esotropia. And then we had to reduce the correction, the minus lenses. And we have to be careful in patients. I personally talked to Kushner also, but he said that none of the patients had developed progressive myopia. But that has to be kept in mind. Depending on the AC by ratio, you have to give the minus lenses. Like if you have AC by ratio of 7 and you have a deviation of 14 or something, then maybe giving a 5 diopter lens, maybe 2 diopter lens. Maybe it's AC by ratio 7, so it will correct up to 14 to 15 prism diopters of exotropia. So that doesn't work like that, but it is approximate what we see when they have high ACBY ratio. So if you don't want to operate those patients, maybe then we can try minus lens therapy. But we have to be careful in patients who have myopia, families who have myopia, and if they have a prematurity history, because then they might be possibly genes for myopia and they may show progression. I don't know how many of your studies patients showed progression of myopia. Did you look at their axial length and progressively followed them for their axial length?
So right now we are following because of one study. Right now with the Ion Master, we are following, but not the each and every patient. And so with how
because if you have more.
Yeah, what was the amount of esotropia they developed? How much ET?
They had a very high ACBY ratio. I don't remember. I think he had around 7 to 8 chapters of ACBY, high ACBY ratio using gradient method for distance. We use the gradient method for distance. So we don't use a heterophoric method. And so those patients then showed a very high ACBY ratio. So that patient developed the consecutive ESO deviation.
Okay.
Then we have to reduce the minus, then the patient's deviation subsided over a period of time. Are you looking at the distance stereo and near stereo? Are you looking at the distance stereo and near stereo?
Sir, in Tirunelveli, right now we are not having any distance stereopsis test.
In Coimbatore?
Yeah, we see, sir, whenever it is possible to measure, we do measure the distance stereoacuity. Hello?
Hello. Yeah, we can hear you. And how was the result of giving minus lenses? How you decided to give how much minus?
Sir, our experience is limited to maybe just 3 or 4 cases.
Okay. In those 3 or 4 cases, how you decided to give how much minus? Did you do an adaptation of them with the glasses?
In those 3 or 4 cases, like what we have observed is the Newcastle grading score and all, there is improvement. Whereas while measurement with the prism cover testing, it doesn't really show that much of decrease. Maybe it will show around 5 or like if it is a deviation of around 20 to 25, it just shows a difference of 5 to 6 prisms. Not much
but
of
a... Did you check them with the patch test? Did you check them with the patch test or...
alternate patching you are asking?
No. Did you check them with the patch test?
Yeah.
This test.
Yeah, yes.
Okay.
Any other questions from anyone else?
Yeah, citicoline I wanted to ask because we are giving citicoline for malignant amblyopia. So we are sending them to the neurologist. Because neurologist prefers to give citicoline for patients with cerebral palsy and neurodegenerative conditions. So Ankita replied that citicoline can be given 1 gram per day for 15 days.
Yes, sir. The trials I came across in the amblyopia studies, they had used this only, sir. For 15 days, they had given 1 gram per day, IM, intramuscular.
Okay. Okay, intramuscular. Okay. We are not giving them intramuscular. We give them in the syrup form because citicoline comes in the syrup form. So I was not very sure how much to give. And the neurologist also was very not sure how much to give for them. So, but we combined citicoline along with the patching therapy. So we had few patients, but we didn't see much improvement. Coimbatore, have you tried citicoline?
No,
for
sir.
Malignant amblyopia, what you do? For malignant amblyopia?
We have not tried citicoline.
For malignant amblyopia, how you treat?
We don't do anything different, sir, except for patching.
Okay. Do you try inverse occlusion?
No, we don't.
Okay. Any other hospital they have tried inverse occlusion or contact lens occlusion?
Contact lens occlusion we have tried. Some of them do very well. One of the actually the surgery was done at Arvind Madurai on PHPV, one doctor's daughter.
Okay.
She is doing very well. You follow up here and there they go. She's having good fixation now. Now she's 1.5, 2. Now I think we can go for visual assessment, but much better visual assessment.
Okay.
But that child is really doing well. At least the fixation is very good, no nystagmus, and that mother is also a doctor.
Yeah.
I have one another kid like that who is improved. Otherwise, any unilateral dense amblyopia, difficult. With contact lens, they do good.
Shashikala, have you tried Aldinger brushes? Or Dr. Sandra?
Shetty, in that initially I tried, I mean long back, when I started this thing after, maybe in 2005 or something like that. And one case developed that after image or something like a diplopic image.
Okay.
I was really, and it took some time for the patient for that image to go, to reassure the patient and everything. That time I really was worried about this thing. But I think it works, the Heidinger's brushes, because I saw in that patient started feeling that diplopia. Visual acuity also improved. Maybe the macular fixation started and then he started having mild confusion
No, few patients we tried inverse occlusion and then we gave Aldinger brushes treatment. The patients who had very poor vision, not improving, but their fixation never improved. It remained still eccentric actually.
So no use in doing it. So you don't practice, right? We don't do here inverse occlusion at all.
We tried, but they are not helping. Sandra, any experience?
No, sir. I don't have experience with Synoptophore. It recently is only working here in Coimbatore.
Okay.
So I don't have experience. I have a question for Dr. Satya and Dr. Shetty. Have you been using Binox for amblyopia therapy, and what is your experience with it? Generally, what is your experience with Binox for amblyopia therapy?
Yes, Satya, you can take it.
Right, because we don't have it here in Tirupati. I mean, whatever I got was from Madurai, but I thought that they prescribe it for 1 month. So either 30 sessions at home, the child have, or on weekdays they would come to the hospital and they reassess at 1 month. And at 1 month they decide about.
We have done a study and we are like waiting to publish it. Maybe if my fellow is there, maybe she can be able to answer. Ritvi, can you tell our this thing study with the Binox? What was your conclusion?
Yes, sir. We prescribed for 1 month, 30 sessions, and in anisometropic amblyopia, it significantly improved visual acuity. And stereopsis, binocular single vision is improved. Stereopsis is not significantly improved.
So if you have anisometropia of anisomyopic hypermetropia,
yes,
those patients will show significant improvement if it is less than -6 diopters of anisometropia. So those patients, we had a 2 cohort of patients who had 1 patching and 1 patient underwent Binox therapy. And those patients with Binox showed some improvement. This was anisometropic. There were not great improvement in the stereo vision, but they had good improvement in their binocular function and their visual acuity. We don't look at their fixation pattern, like whether it changed from paraphobia to foveal fixation, but they had a good improvement in the vision. Statistically significant.
You have used only non-isometropic amblyopia, sir?
Yeah, actually, anisometropic amblyopia. We have tried for other patients also, but they didn't show much improvement.
And what was the age, minimum age you started?
From 7 to 12
years.
Is that with the previous history of patching or along with patching, or is it only Binox?
It was previous history of patching was there, madam, and we did Binox with patching.
And how long did you wait before you see an improvement?
After 1 month follow-up.
How much did you see?
30 patients.
30 patients. Now, how much was the improvement in 1 month, like on an average?
On an average, like significantly, like 2 lines improvement were there.
Okay, thank you.
Is it sustained? It's only 1 month follow-up, or is it sustained improvement of acuity?
And what was what was the least visual acuity you selected?
Exact number actually I forgot the mean visual acuity.
Maybe once it is published, we'll send you across.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If there are no more questions, are there any questions from any other participants? I can't see anything in the chat, so YouTube chat also. If there are no more questions, then we will join back again tomorrow for the session on non-strabismic binocular vision anomalies. And thank you all for joining. Thank you, Kalpana Madam. Thank you, Meena and Sandra and all the speakers for their contribution.